Welcome to Latino Reads, a weekly inspirational video podcast that highlights award-winning authors and leaders, exposes viewers to all types of books, and motivates thinking on a variety of topics. Your host is Maria Elena Cortez. Disfrute. Enjoy.
Hello, welcome to Latino Reads. Today we have an amazing and talented author visiting with us, Georgette Baker. Welcome to the show.
Thank you. It's great to be here.
You're multi-talented and multilingual. That really caught my eye, and you're inspiring so many kids. Tell us a little bit about your background.
Well, one, the reason I'm multilingual is because I like to talk. But I did, I was born on an island in the Caribbean, Aruba, and then I lived in Venezuela 18 years, I lived in Ecuador 3 years, I lived in Greece, and every time I move countries, I want to communicate with people, and so I have to learn the language, and that's what ended up happening. And then my other two languages, my sister would learn one, so I had to compete, the standard brother-sister.
Wow, thing. So you guys were competing. And
competing.
So who knows more languages?
My sister.
Are you serious? How many does she know?
I quit at five. She knows seven.
Seven. And tell us how many you know?
Five.
Five languages. So that is pretty impressive. Now, one of the things that I noticed is that your books are about traveling experiences and highlighting some of the amazing countries you've been at. Which of those places has been the most fun for you?
Well, my favorite place in the whole world are the Galapagos Islands, because you see so many animals concentrated in one place. There are animals that don't exist any place on the planet. And I love it so much that I wanted to tell children about it. And so that's when I incorporated pictures that I'd taken and written about it. And then, well, why write it only in English when I also know Spanish? So all of my books are bilingual. All of my CDs are bilingual. And I just have a passion for things, and I want everybody to know about them, and I think that that's the fountain that spurs on the books.
So you're busy out there traveling and learning. When do you find time to sit down and write?
Yes. You know, everybody has the same amount of time. Basically, it's a choice. What do you want to do with your time? When you stop. And my things are not only based on foreign countries that I've been to. I mean, there are things in my own backyard that I'm very passionate about. And so whatever I encounter and I want to share with somebody, then that's what I pick up.
Now, as a little girl, you mentioned you were with family, you were traveling. But is there anybody in particular that inspired you to become a writer?
You know, some things you just have inside of you, because when I was in junior high school and high school, I would send little articles to 17 magazine. When I went to university, I wanted to write, you know, this or that for a journal. And so there was nobody in my family who was a writer. It was just, maybe that's just another way of talking on paper.
Are you going to schools, conferences, and what kind of topics are you talking about with the community?
Well, you know, because I'm also a performer, so when I go into schools, I'm mostly doing the shows that I've come across, which is Latin American adventure. And then again, I have the opportunity to share the things that I love about Latin America, and I'll incorporate the stories, you know, that I've written about, and then I'll teach people songs, and then I'll teach people Spanish. And so I have a need, or maybe my essence on the planet, is to teach other people, and little people are the ones who'll listen.
So you have a very creative mind. Usually musicians are double gifted, because that's something I don't think I'll ever be able to do, play an instrument nor sing. But so you're very gifted in that.
I don't know if I'm gifted, I'm just loud. You know, I mean, I don't play the guitar very, very well, but I sing loudly. I sing well. And so, you know, the guitar is just an accompaniment.
And you make it fun. So
I try to make it fun.
Want to get become part of the experience. And that's so important. I've heard you do really fun.
I think that, you know, if you want somebody to learn something, you have to make it fun. Otherwise, you just, you know, I mean, the kids are competing. You're competing as a teacher, as a performer, with technology. And so if you're competing with technology, and technology is fast and it's colorful and it's wonderful and the sound, then you have to, you know, bring that too. You have to be colorful,
right,
and bring sound and sing and tell the story and make noises.
And what kind of instruments do you play?
I play at the cuatro, which is a Venezuelan instrument. Mm-hmm. I play at the guitar, and I play at the piano. So basically, I'm not a virtuoso at any of them. I would never make that claim, but you know, I will pick them up and I'll sing loudly.
Well, you're very modest. So These are all your creations, your books.
I have a new one.
Which one is your favorite? First, tell me about your favorite.
My favorite. I guess Periquito is my favorite.
Okay.
For years, I would draw it, then I'd redraw it, somebody else would draw it, and I was always looking for the right pictures to go in the book, and finally, a young Mexican artist did them for me, and I love, there's a picture of Periquito crying that I absolutely adore. But it was a song that I learned in Venezuela. It's very short. Periquito, periquito, te pareces a tu papa, por arriba, por abajo, por delante, por detrás. And kids would go, again!
Oh,
well, how many times can you sing a 3-second song? So I wrote a story where as the periquito goes looking for his father, the animal sings the song. So it repeats throughout the story.
Yes, and kids love repetition.
They do like repetition.
They never get tired of it.
And they like interaction. And so I thought, well, okay, this is a Spanish song. So I translated it to English. So I will do that. Whatever's written in Spanish, I'll do English. Whatever's in English, I will do into Spanish.
Wow. Well, so. I'm sure I would love to come see you and hear you perform.
Well, I have a show coming up.
Awesome.
I will tell you when it is. Yeah.
Awesome. Then, I would love to be there.
But before we go, you know, I want to tell you about my new book.
Yes, please.
Because it's called Hallacas Venezolanas.
Okay.
And it's a very labor-intensive food to make. And one thing that I do when I'm about to do a book is I research things and then I find out things I didn't know, and I guess I like finding out things. And so hallacas, they believe, is a combination of both the Spaniard, the native South American, and the African who were brought there. And so the Spaniards had these luxury foods like olives and almonds, and then they would have meats at their table, and then the scraps would be thrown out. While the slaves and the African workers were given a cornmeal, and that was their main staple food. But what they would do is they would keep, you know, all this leftover thrown out food, and then they would recook that cornmeal and lay it out and put that combination of whatever they had. So now they had olives, now they had raisins, now they had meat in their diet, and they would fold it up in banana leaves, which is what was readily available.
Okay.
And so that's how the Venezuelan hallaca came into be. They do eat it in other parts of the world, like they eat it in Puerto Rico, and apparently there's variations. But
so this book also teaches the kids how to make them, or the families how to make them.
Dice
cómo hacerlas.
Exactamente. It tells you, you know, where it shows you. I like to tell people where a country is. So on all of my books, I show a map. So this is Venezuela.
Then geography connection.
Always.
That's great.
Always. And then so they're the ingredients. And so it's a step-by-step. It's almost like a cookbook. And at the end, there is this story that is unknown. I mean, we really don't know. Nobody told us that this is what happened. But it's thought to be how the process took place.
Yeah. I love books like that because I taught my kids how to about geography and math. And every time I found an opportunity to find books like that, I was like buying them so they became part of their collection. So congratulations.
Thanks.
Sounds like fun.
I agree with you. I think if you want somebody to have fun and learn something, you know, put a song with it, make the story exciting, give them a geographical location.
Connection.
So like in Periquito, all of the animals in there are South American animals. Because I could have thrown in elephants and giraffes and made it different, but I thought, no, they should see what a tarantula looks like. They should see a poison arrow frog. And those things become important to me.
Awesome. Well, thank you so much. It's so exciting. It makes me want to go run home and pick up one of your books.
Well, you can get them online.
That's right.
And Ramona reads. I have girlfriends who read them online, little children who will do book reports, and they're online also. So thank you.
Yes, and we'll be highlighting you in the future as well. So thank you so much for being part of Latino Reads. And we look forward to continue to highlight you and see you in the future.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Georgette Baker is a certified teacher who speaks 5 languages and travels worldwide, sharing her stories with students from all over the world. She's a producer of a children's bilingual book and cassette series called Cantemos. Born in the island of Aruba and raised in Venezuela, Georgette received her teaching credentials from Washington University. In addition to performing, Georgette established her own company and produces a line of children's bilingual books and music. Your students would love her stories, so don't miss out. Invite her to your school.
Welcome to Latino Reads, a weekly inspirational video podcast that highlights award-winning authors and leaders, exposes viewers to all types of books, and motivates thinking on a variety of topics. Enjoy.